Hello and welcome to Animal Watch. And this week it's a very important episode because we're meeting the very last two northern white rhinos on planet Earth.
This episode of Animal Watch has been sponsored by Hi Tec South Africa Clothing. Kenya, vast and wild, the cradle of mankind, as well as home to the big five: lions, cheetahs, Cape buffalo, elephants, and of course, the rhino. Ol Pejeta Conservancy, which spans a staggering 90,000 acres, is the largest black rhino sanctuary in East Africa and home to the world's last remaining two northern white rhinos. This species has been devastatingly brought to functional extinction by war, loss of habitat, and the sinister poaching for their valuable horns. Najin and her daughter Fatou live under 24-hour surveillance in a 700-acre wild enclosure, protected by the rangers of Ol Pejeta and their super team of tracking and guard dogs. Najin lost her father, Sudan, 1 year ago. He was the last male northern white rhino on Earth, and this sent a shudder through the conservation community. Today, I am honored to be meeting the two girls and finding out all about their story and if there is any hope left in resurrecting the species.
So my name is Joseph and you are much more welcome.
As I arrived, I felt very emotional. To think that I was in the presence of the very last two northern white rhinos on Earth.
Over here we got the two northern white rhinos, the only two left in the whole world. Like you can see over here we got Fatou, and this one is Najin.
Najin.
Yeah.
And Najin is the mother of Fatou.
Yeah, Najin is the mother of the Fatou.
And Najin is also the daughter of Sudan, who passed away last year. And of course, he was the very, very last male northern white.
Poaching. You can touch.
May I?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
So you are lucky because you are touching the only two left in the whole world. It's a little bit sad because they are the only two left in the world.
I think it's incredibly sad, actually.
Yeah.
Oh. Gee, I don't even know how I feel right now.
Yeah.
I actually feel quite emotional. And I wanted to come and meet Sudan last year. But, you know, we were a little bit too late for that.
Yeah.
And how old was Sudan when he passed?
So Sudan was 45 years old. So that one is a little bit old for a rhino. If you compare to a human being, that one can be around to 90 to 100 years. Yeah.
So how old is Najin?
So Najin now is 29 years old.
29 years old?
Yeah, and the daughter is 19 years old. Almost 19 years old.
19 years old. So they like to be scratched here?
Yeah, it's a little bit soft. You can even feel it.
It is really soft, and so she'd like a little scratch, would she?
Yeah. So if you scratch him more, you like it. It's like the same thing we have the dogs and the cat at home. If you scratch them, they feel very well. Also, it's the same thing as these rhinos.
Now, Najin here comes from a zoo, doesn't she? Because when you realise that the northern whites were diminishing in numbers, they had to be collected, didn't they, from around the world?
Yeah.
And brought to one place so you could try and reproduce these rhinos before it was too late.
Yeah, when they came here from the zoo, there were four of them. They brought Najin and Fatou,
Yes.
And Sudan and Sunni.
Wow.
So they brought 2 male and 2 female as the program of trying to breed them.
I noticed that Najin's rear hocks were collapsed, and Joseph explained to me why this was.
So even now the legs is a little bit bad, because even for now, if he wanted to get the pregnant, he cannot be able to carry all that time, because the gestation period is between 17 months up to 18 months. So he cannot be able to carry all the pregnant all that time.
Really?
So he can be able to abort any time.
Really?
Because of the bad legs. And that one is the reason why, because he doesn't want anything to happen to them. And the reason why we separate them with the other males. So now they are staying by themselves. Until we lost one of the male in 2014.
Yes.
Which one he died for natural death. And then we lost the other male, which one last year, which one was called Sudan. So now we only left with the two of them.
So it's now unbelievable.
So now we want to do the scientist method. Which one is to try to do the scientist method? Which one is to try to collect the eggs of the female?
Yeah, has that been done already?
Okay, at the moment, they have not yet collected the eggs of the two females.
Yeah.
But the good thing, they managed to collect the sperm of 5 different males before they died.
Okay.
So they are freezing somewhere in laboratory. But for now, the scientists, they are working with the Southern White Rhino, so they can be able to know the good way of getting the eggs out without hurting the animal. And whenever they're going to finish doing that kind of an experiment, then they come to correct with these two. So whenever they correct the eggs, and then they're going to be able to combine the sperms and the eggs, and then they make an embryo.
Yes.
And that embryo is going to be put back to the Southern White Rhino.
Yes.
So the Southern White Rhino is going to be the surrogate mother to carry the pure breed of the Northern White Rhino.
So tell me, when they first came over and you introduced them to the Southern White, what did she need to teach them in order to be rhinos? What were they absolutely lacking, and what did she manage to teach them?
Okay, for one thing, because they came from a zoo, they did not know how to graze the grass, because they were being used to be given like callos, bananas, bread, apples, meal, all kind of booze. And also the other thing, we wanted them to become natural rhinos.
Yes.
So that one is the reason why we keep them with the Southern White Rhino.
So as you can see with the Southern White, she has a pointed horn because she knows how to sharpen it. Whereas the two Northern Whites have a blunt horn because they haven't got a clue what it's like to actually...
But you can see the second horn is they are trying to learn from the Southern White Rhino how to sharpen their horn.
Yes.
So you can see the second horn is a little bit more sharp, although they doesn't know how to sharpen very well like the Southern White Rhino. So they are keeping learning each and every day.
And of course, as you know, people try to come in to get rhinos all of the time, poachers, because the horn is worth so much money in the medicine market of Asia. When really a horn is exactly the same as chewing your fingernail, is keratin, there's nothing more in it, there's no magic cure. But it's worth so much, it's actually worth more than cocaine, a horn of one of these rhinos. And of course, as they get rarer and rarer and rarer, they become more desirable, sadly.
My curiosity to find out if we could save the species took me to head of Ol Pejeta's conservation, Samuel Matusia, in order to find out if there was any hope.
You know, in vitro fertilization in rhinos is something that had never been done before when this problem came up. And so developing procedures, ratifying this and getting them to be accepted within the scientific community took quite a while.
Have you had any success trying to create an embryo with any other type of species of rhino?
This has been done in Europe successfully, and that is why there is confidence. And, you know, we are now energized knowing that we are not longer in the dark, but there is a great measure of potential for success in this project.
Amazing.
Because that has been tried. You know, quite a number of papers have been put forth suggesting on how successful this is likely to be.
So the embryo that has been created in Europe, was, did that go to full term, or was that just in the laboratory?
The idea was actually, what is really interesting is that you've got to create an embryo. It's when you fuse the egg with a sperm, you have to nurture this. It has got to grow to a point where it can be implanted on an animal.
Yes.
Now, that is the process called maturation. Mm-hmm. And that maturation process sometimes is also very tricky. And once you perfect that, then that embryo can actually be frozen.
Mm-hmm.
So you can have as many eggs, but they are frozen within liquid nitrogen for implantation at the appropriate time.
Yes.
So now that this has been perfected, the idea is to get as much eggs as we can, fuse them, mature or nurture them to a point where they can become embryos.
So how close are you to actually being able to harvest these eggs?
Very close, a few months perhaps, because there's an issue of just getting each and every document that is required in place to allow for cross-border movement of these samples.
So when the eggs are harvested, as you were saying, then they're going to be sent off all across the world?
They will be sent to Italy,
yes,
Cremona, Italy, which is a specific lab that have, you know, been good at doing this.
Yes.
And they must be there within 24 hours.
Wow.
So it's got to be quick.
That's an undertaking.
It's got to be quick.
That's
so
an undertaking.
So, you know, you don't need certain approvals once you have the eggs. These approvals need to be have gotten before that time.
Okay, so say they've created now your embryo, which is really exciting, or hopefully yes, multiple embryos. The embryos will then be implanted into your surrogate, southern white rhinos that you have?
That is
on
the plan.
Site?
That is the plan, that this will be done here at Ol Pejeta.
Okay.
Once these are stored, they will then be flown back and implanted here, so that the first population that is created per se essentially should be on Ol Pejeta.
Well, I wish you the best of luck, and it sounds like you guys here are doing absolutely amazing work. I've enjoyed immensely meeting your rhinos, and I wish you the best of luck in the future.
Thank you very much.
After meeting the trio, we paid a visit to the Rhino Memorial, a stone's throw away. And it was again painful to read some of the writing on the plaques about the troubled times of rhino poaching Ol Pejeta has had to endure over the last decade.
Well, I'm here at Sudan's memorial. And behind me, there are lots and lots of memorials for poached black rhinos, which has happened here at Ol Pejeta over the last decade or so. And despite looking behind and seeing all the tragedy of the past, we can think about the hope for the future. So even though Sudan was the last male northern white, and I've met the last remaining two female northern whites, we've also learnt that people are working hard to try and fix what they've done wrong. So despite the poachers decimating the populations of rhinos, rhinos are gradually recovering. And with the hard work that Ol Pejeta's doing, we really, really hope to see some young baby northern white rhinos in the future. And if you liked this episode of Animal Watch, then be sure to give us a big thumbs up and subscribe to the channel by clicking the button in the bottom hand corner. And remember to pop onto Ol Pejeta's website to read about all the amazing and wonderful conservation work that they're doing. Be sure to support them. It's an absolutely beautiful conservancy here, and I've had a wonderful time. Be sure to tune in every week, where I will be bringing you some more heartfelt stories on animal rescue, wildlife, and conservation. Bye for now.